Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bernard Cannon. I'm an editor photographer for the website known as The Photo Pit. We are here at day one of Gen Con 2019. I know a lot of you might be confused for a bit of what Gen Con is, and we'll get to that and talk about it in a little bit. But I want to introduce everyone here to John Compton from Paizo. Hey, John, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. It is a wonderful opening to Gen Con already.
Absolutely.
And as you can probably see in the background, we have all sorts of people here ready to buy Pathfinder 2nd Edition, which is our big release for the weekend.
All right, so let's talk to our fans a little bit about what is Pathfinder, because a lot of them may not know what Pathfinder is, so give us a little background about that.
Sure, so Pathfinder is a game that really was inspired by Dungeons & Dragons about 11 years ago, and so they created their own spin-off, taking a lot of the standard mechanics, but putting their own spin and take on it. And it has been wildly popular for the past decade, and the time has finally come for us to look at a new edition, take all the lessons that we've learned over so many years of publishing, and make an even better game. And improve on all the things that we've seen over the years.
All right, very cool. Let's bring our little video person in over here so get a little bit of a group so you want to see. So this is what we have here is Pathfinder 2nd Edition. Talk to Elizabeth about the actual book itself.
Yeah, so the Pathfinder 2nd Edition core rulebook is 640 pages of new RPG content. So not only are you going to have the possibility of playing new wonderful classes, like in this case the Barbarian, a Rage Warrior capable of using their primal power to embrace totem abilities, spirit abilities, but also like the Sorcerer, you have a magical bloodline that will give you power. So we have spellcasters, we have warriors, we have scoundrels and martial artists of all stripes. So one of the big things about Pathfinder from the very beginning has been the customizability of it. There are always so many wonderful options so you can build exactly the character you want to and have so many possibilities from the get-go. Whether that is in the various, from the various ancestries, like in this case, elf, and gnome, and halfling. Then you have a class that you're also going to build off of. You're going to have feats, which are different variations on your special powers. And new to 2nd Edition are class feats, which are further ways to customize your character's class or profession or shtick to make them different from everybody else who has the same name.
Awesome.
Yeah, so one of the big pillars of Pathfinder 2nd Edition is maintaining the same level and depth of customizability.
Okay.
But the two big things that are also there are ease of play and ease of learning.
Okay.
Because Pathfinder 1st Edition, for all of the wonderful depth, it had a lot going on. So, for some people, it was a lot to process. And that, we recognize that. So we wanted to make sure in 2nd Edition that we could make it easier for people to pick up and play.
Okay.
And we've really done a knockout job of this.
Awesome.
On all of this. So, one of the big points, especially for anybody who has touched on tabletop role-playing games before, is that instead of having all sorts of different action types, the core idea here is that you just have three actions, period, per turn.
Okay.
And if it's a verb, it's probably an action.
Do you want to
open the door, pick up the bottle, throw it at the goblin? Great, that's your turn. Do you want to attack, and be a murder machine? That's your call.
Okay.
So it's a lot easier to process how long is this action going to take, because it's probably one action.
Right. So now I know a lot of fans, some fans may be new to RPGs, right? And you said there's ease of play, ease of learn.
Yeah.
What's a normal person like to go ahead and like pick up Pathfinder to start to learn it? Like, how long would they take to be able to like just easily get this book, maybe understand the rules, etc.?
It's probably going to depend on your environment and group, because it's always going to be a different experience for a tabletop RPG group when you have somebody who does know the system already versus somebody who doesn't.
Right.
And that is, so if you're just starting into 2nd Edition and it's just your group with no prior experience, it's going to take a little while to process and grok some of the rules.
Right.
We presented it in as easy to read from cover to cover sort of experience as possible.
Okay.
But you have a couple of different options. For example, if you're at the show, you can be running our demos, which are right across the way on our booth.
Okay.
So you can sit down and see in a course of an hour or less what the experience is, and you can learn hours and hours of lessons
just from that
experience. We have the Sagamore Ballroom at Gen Con, which is 150 different tables. I know! It's so great. And we're going to be able to get through like 10,000 different people in that Sagamore Ballroom. So it's going to be an amazing experience.
That's very good.
So those are great ways to get to learn. But if you want to see Pathfinder 2nd Edition in action as well, we've also done several different actual play podcasts and introductions elements to it.
Okay.
Most famously, on Thursdays, we have the ongoing campaign Oblivion Oath, run by Jason Bullman, the design lead for Pathfinder.
And where do they find that?
They'll be able to find that at Paizo's Twitch channel,
okay.
Which is, I believe, Paizo Twitch? Paizo, at official Paizo?
Google Paizo Twitch, too.
Yeah, we'll be able to figure that one out. That's what I get for saving bookmarks.
That's okay.
So they run that every Thursday. It's another hour of the ongoing storyline.
Okay.
And you can find the back episodes on YouTube.
All right.
So if you just want to see it in action, say, is this for me? You can check that out, too.
There you go. So make sure to go check that out, Paizo Twitch, and find that ongoing campaign and see if this game is definitely for you, especially if you're new to the RPG world.
And if you don't want to check it out on visually, but you're not at Gen Con, but you want to play it yourself, that is where the Organized Play Program really comes into play. Because the Organized Play Program has different 1- and 4-hour experiences happening worldwide every weekend or even every weeknight, and it can be in your area. So you can go to paizo.com, and there's an Organized Play tab.
Cool.
You can check out, there's a coordinators button from there that will show you all of the venture officers. These are volunteer coordinators,
okay,
who are in your area. Find your state, find your country, find the person closest to you, and go ahead and email your closest venture captain or venture lieutenant or venture agent, and say, this is who I am, this is where I am, and how can I get involved? And they will let you know what your local resources are and what your local events are.
Cool.
And you can just show up. If you want to play a pre-generated character to get a taste of things, you always can, and they will run the games for you.
That's awesome. So this is perfect for those who are new and intro to the RPG world to be able to find now a way to learn Pathfinder, play Pathfinder in their own local area.
Absolutely.
All right.
Or the great thing about organized play is it's opt-in as much as you want. So if you just want to show up once or twice, that's cool.
Right.
If you want to play every week, you can do that too.
That's cool, yeah.
And if you miss a session, it's no problem. Unlike a home game where it's like, oh, you know? Well,
yeah, oh, I missed last
Bernard
week.
Bernard wasn't here, so I guess we had to cancel. Way to go, buddy.
I would never do that. Let's so we now have a bunch of other products we want to take a look at. Let's follow us this way.
Sure.
See what else we have going on here. Yep. So right over here we have...
So we had the core rule book, the standard version over there. But here we have the special edition, sort of faux leatherette cover. You're going to have the same great content in here. But it sure is a fancy gold leaf version of it. Got your own little navigation ribbons in there as well. So it is a great sort of commemorative one. And if you're here at the show in particular, there's nothing finer to get signed than the special edition version of things.
Yep.
So put it on your shelves, use it in your games, you're gonna have no regrets in picking up this version.
Absolutely. And then what do we have over here in this one?
So we already have 640 pages of the core rulebook content, but you probably want to be able to run some games with creatures in them. Something to actually sink your teeth into or sink your sword into, as luck might hold. So we have our updated version of the bestiary. Got our trolls and hydras and kobolds on the front cover. This is 360 pages, chock full of different creatures. A lot of old favorites, because we want to make sure that if you have been running Pathfinder games already, that you can then adapt them into the second edition with as few problems as possible. So you'll find some classics, you'll find your green dragons, you'll find Grave Knights, I worked on that one, Banshees and Dragon Turtles, but also a couple of completely new ones that we've never worked on before or published before, to make sure that it's not just rehashing what you thought you knew and showing you what those look like, but also, what are some completely new ideas that we can show off?
Very cool.
So 360 pages of this levels basically -1 through 20. -1 is just sort of a minion level creature.
Okay.
But these are great for running your own game, as well as any of the other published adventures that we have, which are
awesome.
Drawing heavily on these.
Awesome. And now you did have some other stuff that you brought along with us here to take a look at.
Yeah, speaking of published adventures, I really want to show off two of the published adventures that we are featuring here, in addition to the organized play scenarios that
okay.
we have. So I do want to make sure we don't overshadow that there are 4 new playable Pathfinder Society scenarios in 2nd edition.
Very cool.
That represents another 16 to 20 hours of adventure content. But on top of that, we also have a repeatable quest, which is a 1-hour experience, in case you just want to get a taste of organized play.
Very cool.
And along with that, we have 18 different iconic pre-generated characters online for download,
nice.
Too.
Nice, okay.
So if you don't want to build your own, you want a taste, we got this covered as well.
Sounds good. So what do we have here?
So the first, really the thing that got Paizo started wasn't even the Pathfinder game. It was the Pathfinder Adventure Pack. So these are 6 volume adventures that take you from level 1 to 20. And in this case, this is the Age of Ashes Adventure Path. So volume 1 will be bringing out the other volumes over the course of the remainder of 2019.
Okay.
You should definitely get a subscription of this, so that it will always be delivered to your door if you're so inclined. Of course, these will also show up at game stores, and you can get them at Paizo.com.
Okay.
I recommend the subscription, in part because now we can get volume 5, which I wrote. Always fun. But the nature of these adventure paths is that they're going to give you about 60 pages of adventure content. They're going to give you the maps that you need to run it. They're going to give you the stat blocks for special creatures. And they're also going to reference some of the things like from the bestiary as well.
Okay.
So you got about 60 pages of adventure content. You also have the adventure toolbox. This is a new feature that we've been really expanding in second edition. This is going to give you all of the preview of what's coming up for plotline information for the subsequent adventures.
Okay.
Because this is leading up to a showdown with a big, bad, evil guy, of course. Why not know what's coming up so you can start to drop seeds as you run your game? So we have all this adventure background for the GM, including a timeline of things that led up to the adventure campaign. We have NPC profiles. These are important people in the course of the adventure, like this goblin scholar. He's so happy! So we got folks like that. We also have new bestiary entries as well. Some of these are featured in the adventure. So even if your players have picked up the bestiary hardcover, you still have some surprises waiting for them.
Very cool.
So that is the adventure path, and that is an ongoing thing. We make a new one of these every month.
Wow.
Yeah. Speaking of awesome adventure content to start off with, The Fall of Plaguestone. This is a 64-page module that'll take you from about level 1 to about 4 or 5.
Okay.
It represents about 40 hours of gameplay content.
Okay.
And it's not just a way of getting you started on 2nd edition. This is a story about how your gaming group, your party, got together.
Oh, that's cool.
Skip the tavern.
Origin stories are always fun.
Jump into Plaguestone, which, I mean, now that I say it like that, doesn't sound positive, but... You know, we need some conflict here.
Yeah, that's all right.
This is going to be the sort of thing that gets your adventure rolling, whether you want to homebrew the rest of your campaign or what. This will get you going. So again, it's going to be about 45 or so pages of adventure content. And then, of course, we have some back matter articles, the adventure toolbox, a gazetteer of all the stuff that you're seeing, some major NPCs, and some unique rewards as well for every one of your campaigns. So this is Fall of Plaguestone, 64 pages. That is also part of our launch. But it has some rather complex maps to draw. So what I really want to highlight, too, why not just have the maps ready to go? So we've been doing flip map products for quite a while now. What this is, it is a unique double-sided map that is the Plaguestone maps. These are wet and dry erasable. They will wet and dry erase to the end of time.
Nice.
So it is wonderful to put these down in full color, not have to draw all the curves and whatnot, and show it off to your players as a great experience that it's going to be.
I always thought that was half the fun, though, to always draw those map out. 5x5 squares, here we go.
I know. But we might as well make it easy for you and give you all the tools you need.
That's
so
cool.
In addition to all these second edition hardcover books, we have a variety of new accessories. We have, again, those organized play scenarios. So whatever it is that you want to do to get started in second edition, we have it here.
Okay, that sounds good. So what is it about Pathfinder, if I had to ask the one question, what is it about Pathfinder you love the most?
The thing about Pathfinder that I love the most has really been the setting, which is what drew me in from the beginning.
Okay.
So some people have described it as a kitchen sink style setting because... Like, if you have a genre you like for fantasy, there's some sort of country out there that probably covers it.
Right.
But the more that I've gotten into it as a developer, the more that I've really recognized that all these nations can still play together in really cool ways and can tell stories together that can cross over in any way you like.
That's awesome. Sounds good. So, but now, even though Pathfinder is such the big hit, you know, here at Gen Con this year, there's something else that's also you guys have been pushing big. What game is that?
We've also been pushing
Starfinder.
And it's not just Starfinder, but I also want to make sure that we're not forgetting the Pathfinder Adventure card game, which we released in May with an updated version of it.
Okay.
It's not a completely new game or new edition, but it's an update to the existing rules that is streamlined so much as well. So that launched in about May that we have here at the show as well.
Okay.
But Starfinder is fantastic,
too. Let's make our way over to there and let's find some Starfinder books so we can show everyone.
Yeah.
All right. We're going to follow him right over here on this wonderful walking tour. We're here at the Paizo booth, by the way, which is number 103 here at the Exhibitors Hall at Gen Con and Hall H-I-J, a whole big yard. But right over here, let's talk about science fiction RPG.
Yeah, sci-fi fantasy, in fact, because you can have sci-fi where it's sort of like when you're playing Alien or the like, where it's kind of on the edge of space travel. This is sci-fi fantasy, where not only is there the whole sci-fi aspect, but there's a mystical element of it.
Okay.
So if you want to, you might almost think of it like a little bit like Star Wars or Star Trek have their psychics or their Jedis or what have you,
right,
where there's a magical element. So Starfinder brings more of that magical side of things to sci-fi. So this is our core rulebook. This is the starting point for everything. So this is going to give you your 7 playable ancestries. It's going to give you your 7 playable classes. We recommend different tropes for each of the classes so you can sort of see what's possible. What are some ideas to start with? Because even though some people show up to fantasy games and they have a Lord of the Rings sense of how to do it. Some fantasy role players show up to sci-fi and they say, I don't know where to begin.
Right.
And having these suggestions can be a great way to start people's cognitive cogs starting to spin as they consider what's possible. So new options and everything. This is the operative, who is sort of our spy-style character. We have the Solarian, who is a mystical warrior. We have just, if you want to play a gritty soldier, awesome, we have that too, technomancers. So this is a way to do sci-fi fantasy, and this is the way that it starts.
So how much of Pathfinder to Starfinder conversion are we looking at? Are they very similar? Are we talking about two really different games here? How much do they, compare and contrast for each other?
So if you know Pathfinder First Edition, you are really close to understanding everything about Starfinder.
Okay.
They're very, very similar. Pathfinder Second Edition is a bit more of a departure from First Edition and Starfinder, but it's still a very approachable and familiar feeling game.
Okay.
So if you know Pathfinder 1, you're about 90% of the way to Starfinder. All right?
Perfect.
So you're going to be great. And even if you want to get a bit of a more basic intro, one of the products that we released earlier this year is the Starfinder Beginner Box. You might have seen this already if you're a Pathfinder fan for a Pathfinder Beginner Box. The idea of this is not only is this a self-contained version of the game, it comes with a map, it comes with character sheets, it comes with all sorts of play aids, a player book, a GM book. These punch out pawns, so you have the figures, a set of dice, everything you need to start playing out of the box. You can crack this thing open, and the heft of this thing. This is like the self-defense version of the game. But it's also a slightly simplified version of the game as well, because it is not only a way to get started on RPGs, but it's also a great way, I find, for children to get started on the game too. So we have, for Organized Play, been doing a program called Pathfinder Society Academy.
Right.
And now we're doing Starfinder Society Academy.
Yes.
Which is a great way of getting children at the table for a two-hour session or so to start showing them what RPGs are all about.
Yep.
And on top of that, at a show like Gen Con, to be so easy to get lost in the crowd, why not give people of all ages material that they can play
as a
family?
I will admit, I absolutely love that when I saw that in the booklet. And my two little ones, one who's behind the camera right now, hi Brady, and my other one who's right over here, Isabella, they are both going to be as part of the Starfinder Academy. We're doing that event tomorrow. So,
excellent.
Yeah, I love the fact that Paizo took the opportunity to say, let's bring the kids into this too and make something special for them.
Yeah, and so the idea with the Starfinder Beginner Box is that you can continue to be creating your own adventures off of it, but that it is self-contained with its own adventure, which you'll be playing later on this weekend,
awesome.
It sounds like. And then when you're done with the beginner box, if you decide, I want more options, I want more complexity, I want more stories, that's the time to then transition over to the full Starfinder rules, because again, this is very much a starting point.
Right.
But if you want to stay at this level of complexity, nothing's stopping you.
All right.
So we have, just as a real quick overview, we have our core rule book. We have different setting books like the Pact Worlds. So this is our setting itself.
Where, I love that guy. Who's that?
I know. This is a Neshalora, which is a type of T-Rex style alien that lives on one of our jungle planets.
Okay.
You can see our Mystic and our Solarian, our mystical warrior, facing off against this guy who has a terrifying scythe tail. I know. Real scary. Some people said, it's great that we have the basic equipment in here, but we want more equipment.
Oh,
we want more
gearbox,
power armor.
Yes.
We want more guns. We want more technological devices. That's the armory.
That's awesome.
And then when we say, okay, well, we have a bestiary for Pathfinder. What do we have for Starfinder?
Right.
That's when we start to get things like the Alien Archive and the Alien Archive 2.
Okay.
We have an Alien Archive 3 that is coming out next month.
Awesome.
As well. So even more character, or even more creature options. Like, in this case, the Squawks. If you wanted to have an intelligent, but raccoonish-style fox familiar sort of creature, you got it.
He's very
if
cool.
If you want herd animals from all of your weird planets, here are templates to create your own.
Oh, that's cool.
Including these space llamas. With six legs.
Oh, so it's like zombie llama.
Hey, I know! Or dust mantis. So basically, if you can think of some sort of weird alien, we have already started. It's already in there. Or
that's
we've
awesome.
Given you the tools to create your own in Alien Archive 1.
Cool.
And on top of that, one thing I want to focus on. Some of these guys, they're aliens, sure, but they have playable statistics. And Alien Archive is really Starfinder in general, is all about this, what we call cantina effect.
Okay.
Where, for Pathfinder, you might be like, I want my humans, my elves, and my dwarves. Okay, that's the fantasy I want.
Right.
But when Starfinder, no, I want to play weird aliens. Can I just play a blob of ooze in a spacesuit?
Sure you can.
Yes, you can.
That's cool.
Okay, so these Alien Archive books can also be great player resources because each one of them has somewhere around 15 playable alien species
in it, too. That's a lot for...
That is a lot. So, and even then, there's still creatures that you could be going up against, too.
Right.
So, Alien Archive books are great on that regard.
That's awesome.
But just behind you, we have all of our Adventure Path volumes. So, just like we had Age of Ashes, we have several different Adventure Path volumes as well. So, the great thing about Adventure Paths is each one is a different theme. So, if you just want to be doing things like, I want a classic sci-fi story, great, Dead Sons is for you. Do you want to go against the evil space empire? Then, Against the Aeon Throne on the right there is the one for you. Do you want to play space horror? You can do that in Signal of Screams.
You got me there.
And if you want to be if you want to have an adventure where you fly into the middle of the sun, because sci-fi fantasy, then you're also going to want our final adventure path that we have coming out. And so we have all sorts of different possibilities, and we bring out another one of these every month.
Every month.
Every month.
So are these part of the subscription-based ones that you have?
That's right. So we have brought all of our catalog with us today. So what you see here represents the past 2 years of work when we released Starfinder 2 years ago.
Okay.
And on top of that, just as a fun little tchotchke, as I can see, in the middle here, you can see some fun pins.
Yep.
So one of the creatures we have going down the middle of the rack there are called Skittermanders, which are basically fluffy little Ewoks with six arms. And they are super helpful. They live to help. And so people have been so excited about these Skittermanders that we've been bringing out little pieces of swag for them.
That's cool.
So they're here in five different colors, and they're super cute.
Awesome. That is awesome. So the what's your favorite thing about Starfinder, as I asked you with Pathfinder? What's one thing you love about Starfinder the most?
One of the things I love about Starfinder is really tied into Starfinder Society. That's okay. Our organized play program.
Yep.
And the idea is that Starfinder allows us to explore so many wonderful tropes from modern times that we could not do in fantasy.
Oh,
so when it comes to Starfinder Society, we have a scenario that is about playing on a reality TV show.
Oh.
That basically you have a team that is following you around as you explore as archaeologists. And they're like, so show us what you do as archaeologists.
Oh, that's
and
great.
And the more you play up to the camera, the more like credit you get.
That's cool.
You also have things like Save the Rencrotas, which is a scenario about saving these T-Rex creatures, but it's a Save the Whales gala.
Oh, that's great.
And of course, it's an adventure, so bad stuff happens. But that's stuff that we couldn't do in Pathfinder.
Right.
But Starfinder allows so much like modern day commentary and trope playing that is so wonderful to create as a developer.
See, I've always been a big sci-fi fan when it comes to games and such. Star Frontiers was one of my favorite of all time, back from the ages. So to see that Paizo has done something, you know, now more sci-fi based, I really love. That's awesome. Great to see.
And just like with Pathfinder Society stuff, there's Starfinder Society. So if you want to try out a game and sort of just no skin in the game, you can totally look up, again, who your local coordinators are, email them and say, I want to start this.
Awesome.
And they'll let you know how to get going.
That is awesome. All right. So with all that's going on here today and over the next 4 days, you know, we see that, you know, your booth has happened. It's busy, and we love that. That's great. Congrats to you guys on that one. Let me ask you one question, at least kind of off the cuff here, when it comes to Gen Con. What's Gen Con mean to you? Out of all the years, I'm sure you've been here as number of years as I used to come here, but what's that mean to you?
Gen Con is something that, Gen Con really represents an evolution of my understanding of what it means to go to a convention, because Gen Con is something that I attended in, maybe, I think it was like 2007.
Okay.
But I went there as just a casual fan, so I went there to tour the exhibit hall, and I didn't know what I was looking for. I didn't know that there were running games. I didn't know that there were panels or anything like that. But when I started volunteering as an organized play leader, then I started to learn not only is there more that's happening behind the scenes if you just ask around, but people are willing to share their passions with you. And as a volunteer running games, seeing what different play styles are that are outside of my home game, seeing different GMing styles was so critical to my development as a gamer and ultimately getting me into the industry. Because if I had not been a volunteer for organized play, I would have never been recognized as somebody to possibly join Paizo.
There you go. And what's your current role with Paizo? Because you told, as we talked right before, you're moving up in Paizo's, at least out of your role. So what's your current role today now?
So I have most recently been the organized play lead developer, which I've done for 6.5 years.
Okay.
So I've been the head of the creative content for the organized play programs. I will now be moving over to the Starfinder team as a senior developer.
Very cool.
Where I'll be working on a bunch of the stuff that I was showing you today.
Congrats. That's awesome. Good stuff there.
It's going to be great.
All right. Sounds good. What last words did you have for our fans about either Paizo, Starfinder, Pathfinder, whatever else that you you know, want to say what's on your mind today?
Sure. There is so much wonderful stuff that we're coming out with. There are three different great systems, the Adventure Card Game, Starfinder, and Pathfinder. They all have their organized play programs. So it is all the easier even online as well for virtual tabletop games and play by posts to get involved and to try out these games. So especially for second edition, which we're launching today, I encourage you to try out the games, see what it's like in person, and see for yourself if it's the game for you.
All right. Perfect. John, thank you so much for spending time with us today. I greatly appreciate it. Once again, my name is Bernard Canna for the website known as The Photo Pit. We're going to be here at Gen Con for all 4 days. You know, maybe I'll get some video of my two little ones. We're going to be doing the Starfinder Academy, and we'll see how that goes. But keep an eye out on the website for more videos and whatnot, and we will see you guys soon. Thanks so much.
Bye-bye.
All right.